All right, I think we're live. Yay. Welcome everyone to the first installment of my new Hangout series, Wellness Wednesday, when we tackle all of the complicated questions in the world of personal health. For those of you who don't know, I'm Phoebe Lapine. I'm a chef, a cookbook author, and blogger behind the site feedmephoebe.com. And over there, I focus on healthy recipes, gluten-free finds, and, of course, snapshots from my own personal health journey. So I'm really glad that you're joining us for our first installment, because we are going to be talking about green beauty with two really amazing women. I have Kristen Arnett here, who's the founder of the site Green Beauty Team. Say hi, Kristen.
Hello.
You'll notice that there's some Justin Bieber posters in the background. She'll explain why that is and where she is in a second. Kristen's also an international celebrity makeup artist and just all-around great advocate for all things sustainable beauty. And then we have Britta Plug, who is another writer for Green Beauty Team. She's the skincare expert. And in addition to having her own hands-on practice in Brooklyn, she also is a nutrition and health coach and helps people kind of heal from the inside out in terms of their face. So,
hi everyone!
Yay! Hello! So, first of all, green beauty is like the final frontier in my life. It's something that I've struggled with. I've had a bunch of skincare issues. I was just saying that my skin may look fine today, but it's currently covered up with lots of non-organic makeup. So I'm really excited for the conversation because I could use some serious baby steps towards changing all of that. And then the second is that I'm super excited to have Kristen here for like my inaugural Wellness Wednesday voyage, because the night that we met in the fall was actually a huge inspiration for why I started this series in the first place. We were at a Cascadian Farm event with a bunch of other cool ladies in the space, and I don't know how the conversation spiraled as out of control as it did, but we were talking about, you know, frozen organic berries, and then all of a sudden we were talking about acne and thyroid issues and birth control and all just playing off of one another. And I came away just feeling incredibly inspired and also just thinking about, wow, these women are all spokespeople in the world of healthy living, and if they're all having as much trouble navigating these questions as I am, I can't imagine what people who are really just starting on the journey towards living a healthier life must be feeling. So we're all facing the same challenges, and I'm just happy to be able to provide a platform to keep that conversation going. So now, to turn it over to you ladies, I want to hear all about your personal story, how you got started and your careers, whether or not the green side of things was something that you're always concerned with, or if you discovered it along the way. Kristen, why don't you tell us everything about yourself?
Everything. Well, for 5 hours, I can I can tell you everything. But the quick version is that I grew up in a really standard, normal family. We didn't talk about organic. We didn't talk about whole foods. And so I learned it along the way. And part of it was I grew up in Southern California, and I was really connected to nature, but it wasn't from that holistic standpoint. And then I moved to Portland, Oregon. And in Portland, people are much more into the sustainable conversation. And so that's when it got into my ear. And I became much more aware of my impact on the environment. And then I lived in Milan, Italy. And it was there that I met a model who I had known actually for some time, but we re-met in Milan. And I watched her as she was slathering herself with olive oil. And I thought she was completely weird, but her skin looked amazing, and I felt comfortable enough to ask what the heck she was doing, and that started my education and journey into that there were even toxic chemicals in makeup to be aware of. And that model, incidentally, is Mae Lindstrom. Mae Lindstrom is now also a contributor and an expert on Green Beauty Team, but she also has an amazing skincare line that she developed. So it really came full circle. I think the universe put all of these pieces in at the right time when I was most ready to hear them, and it has been a journey. It was not something that came naturally to me. I was a Taco Bell eater. you know, yeah, I mean, I'm just going to say it. Burger King, you know, all that kind of good stuff. And I also had skin issues that I struggled with since the age of 15. I had been on every cyclin antibacterial that the dermatologist would give you topically and internally. I did low-dose rounds of Accutane. I mean, I really struggled with my skin. And it wasn't until I cleaned up my diet and I stopped using really harsh stuff on my face that I, for the first time in my life, saw my skin look good. And that alone was enough for me to make the jump into personally doing this as a lifestyle, but then professionally doing it as well, because I knew it was better for my clients.
Amazing. That's so interesting. And I think the more and more I talk to different practitioners of all sorts, everyone has a personal story, and a lot of them have come to their craft through their own struggles with some of these issues. So, and I know, Britta, that's definitely part of your story, so why don't you take the reins?
Yeah, so I struggled with skin issues as well. You know, once the hormones started kicking in at like 12 or 13 years old, there it was, like my forehead, my T-zone, it was just a really awkward, pimply mess. And we had actually just recently moved to Germany from the suburbs of Canada. And so all of a sudden, there was this like different way of doing things. You know, it's sort of like when Kristen moved to Portland. Like all of a sudden, instead of, you know, being prescribed, you know, medicine for my constant colds and ear infections, they would prescribe me these herbal teas, and I would go to the apothecary, and they would hand blend them, and it was really beautiful. And so when I went to the dermatologist with my skin issues, they had me do weekly facials, which was covered by health insurance. Beautiful. And that was really, that was a huge inspiration to me, and we were very lucky to have a sauna in our house there, which wasn't as extravagant as it sounds. But I would have all my girlfriends over for spa night, and we would, you know, do these little face masks and play with, you know, essential oils, and it really got me interested in natural beauty. And then, you know, and from then on, I did everything naturally always. There were many, many, many little steps. I had an older sister, who was like the first vegetarian I ever knew of. I didn't know what vegetarian was until my older sister came home and was like, I'm not eating meat anymore. I didn't know that was an option. And she, you know, she worked in health food stores all throughout college, and I would go visit her, and she would save me the foam off the top of the carrot juice in the back and give me my carrot juice foam. And so I had all these, you know, different influences from living in Germany and then the sort of like hippie sister. And it was really in my early 20s when I got this like full body psoriasis. Like we're talking like socially painful. Like I spent a full summer in tights and leggings. Like I couldn't wear shorts or skirts because I had this rash all over, and I was trying to like date people and be like, no, it's not contagious, I promise. And finally I realized, like, oh, it's my lifestyle that's doing something here. Like, I was in my early 20s in New York, you know, staying out too late, partying a little too much, maybe not eating the best foods, even though I sort of had a good idea of what was good for me. And that was really a catalyst to start getting into yoga, meditation, and really looking at different parts of my diet that weren't working, because my only option was to slather on this ointment that the dermatologist prescribed. Like, I didn't have any solutions that were working for me naturally, nor did I really have the resources for that at that time. And I was just like, I'm done getting these pound tubs of ointment from the dermatologist every month. Like, I did not want to live that way anymore. And so that sort of started the spiral of seriously doing that for myself, and also turning my skincare career in the direction of going back to naturals after getting lost in the spa world for a few years, just sort of realizing, like, oh, this is what's real to me, and this is the truth to me, and this is what I want to be presenting to the world.
That's so great. So it's a perfect segue, because I think a lot of people who just turn to traditional dermatologists, which I have for my whole life and have been, like you guys, prescribed antibiotic after antibiotic and all these crazy topical creams that, you know, sometimes worked and sometimes would just like burn away at my face. And sometimes they worked, and then the second I stopped taking them, it would come right back, which, you know, that just tells you that it's just a Band-Aid for the problem and nothing's really being fixed. So you see a lot of different clients. What are the trends in terms of, like, the internal fix versus the external, of course, using very toxic chemicals to treat these issues? Like, do you see, like, common pitfalls with diets that are almost always the case? Obviously, it's always so individual. But, yeah, just talk a little bit about kind of the different drivers and how they interplay.
Absolutely. And there are some really, really common threads that I see. And sometimes it can be really simple. Like, for example, with acne, I see a lot of lactose intolerance or dairy issues. With things that are more rash-like, I see a lot of gluten intolerance. That's not the rule, but it's definitely a trend that I see, that those conditions improve greatly when those food groups are removed from the diet. Sometimes I get really lucky and we just like make a quick little fix there and then they're good to go, and other times it's a whole journey and there's multiple healers involved and you know, it gets a lot more complex. But healing the gut is really, really, really essential to healing the skin. Probiotic therapy can be incredibly beneficial. And you know, I was noticing throughout my career, even once I got more natural and sort of holistic with things, that what I was doing from the outside had its limitations. I could really only do so much. And even though it's a much better solution than the dermatologist prescribed pharmaceutical Band-Aids, they were still not getting down to the root cause. And so that's when I went to school for holistic health coaching, so that I could integrate that piece into my work as well. And let's look at, you know, what's going on inside? How can we get down to the roots a little bit more? And again, you know, sometimes it's really complex and beyond the scope of what I can do, but that's why I'm also so grateful to work in conjunction with an acupuncturist and herbalist, and we can all really, you know, bring our expertise to the table and try and help people, you know, have their best skin naturally without the chemicals and something that is sustainable for them.
It's so interesting because, I mean, I'm on the journey right now. Kristen referred me to one of her healers when I asked her if she knew of a natural dermatologist. And, yeah, for me, I'm autoimmune, and so I naturally think that, like, when I break out, it could be because I had a trace of gluten or something like that, and that it's allergy-related. But according to the healer, it was something going on in my liver, which could be because I live the lifestyle that you may have described earlier about your 20s, to a lesser degree now that I'm 28 than I was when I was 24. But it's definitely now starting to take into consideration those changes. And I have a great arsenal of people. You're going to be one of them now, but an acupuncturist, et cetera. But what would you tell someone who doesn't necessarily have access to all these amazing people who don't live in New York City, where, like, not just access, but options for every single person that we just described. What would you tell them? Do you think, like, an elimination diet, if their skin is acting up, is a smart first course of action? Yeah, it's so tough.
Yeah, I think really, you know, not everyone has access to Whole Foods or organic food stores. But keeping it as simple and as natural as you can in terms of diet, eating whole foods, getting rid of boxes and packages as much as possible, and keeping a food journal, I would say, is really the first course of action. Noticing what you're feeling after you eat certain foods. Does that give me a stomach ache? Am I bloated? Does my skin break out after this? Do I have joint pain, headaches? Those are all different symptoms that food allergies can present as. It's not always like, oh, I have a stomach, like, stabbing stomach pain, and then I break out. It can manifest in different ways for different people. But just starting to, like, shine the light of awareness and notice what's happening in your body, noticing how the foods are feeling. And then from there, you can start to play with, like, oh, well, every time I eat this, X, Y, or Z happens. Why don't I try removing that for a few weeks, see how I feel, reintroduce it, see how that feels, And if there is an issue with that food, usually you'll have a more pronounced reaction after it's been removed from your system for a few weeks. So that will give you a lot of good information without having to see specialists, just really tuning into what's going on in your own body.
It's funny because I feel like the conversation, at least when I was growing up and reading a lot of like the 17 magazines and Cosmos of the world, which is like how I got a lot of my first like early grooming information, I feel like as far as like the dietary conversation was concerned, like all you really heard about is like, oh, chocolate makes you break out, like potato chips, and very basic things like that. So it's like you're thinking about it partially that diet is somewhat to blame, but not necessarily thinking about in terms of allergies and the deeper issues. Are there any like myths like that that you can think of that are just, you think are so foolish and people should just forget about, like the chocolate and potato chips?
Yes, definitely. People still hang on to that chocolate one, which is really funny. And I'm sort of like, well, do you think it's the chocolate or the sugar in your chocolate? Like, why don't we just upgrade that and get you some really amazing dark chocolate? You know, look at the ingredients, get the one with the lowest sugar content, and, like, eat that shit, you know? Or, you know, even make your own. You know, get some raw cacao, some coconut oil, mix it up, and make a funny little dip with that stuff. But I don't think it's like cacao itself. I think it's the sugar and possibly all the other stuff that's in there that we really don't need.
And I'd love to jump in, too, with regards to diet, because I tried to address my diet with limited resources a long time ago. And I read a really great book called The Anti-Acne Diet by Dr. Perricone. And his whole thing was sugar causes acne, sugar causes wrinkles, sugar causes inflammation in the body. And this was back in the, I don't know, the mid-90s, I think, when this book came out. And if somebody, I feel like, is struggling with a lot of skin issues or even just health issues in general, sugar is probably one of the biggest culprits in what's going on as far as an imbalance on the body. And there's just so much research now and documentation about how even cancer cells are feeding off glucose and sugars, and our processed foods are filled with sugar, our breads are filled with sugar. And so just becoming aware of the amount of sugar intake in those silent little ways that they're sneaky, that sugar shows up in our diet, and seeing if we can't pull back some of that and what that effect then is on the body. Because for me, it was huge. I saw that my skin actually did look less inflamed and I did have less issues. And the cyclical addiction of sugar is really very similar to how people are addicted to drugs. It's sort of the same neural pathways that get formed. So it's, I think, quite a big issue that most people ignore. And that can be one of the first things that changes how your body functions and how your skin looks, especially if you're at all interested in not aging too quickly. The inflammation that happens in those cells is what promotes wrinkling.
So just to, because actually I feel like the sugar conversation, I'm hearing little bits of it in every field now. Would you say that that applies to all sugars or just white refined sugars? Raw cane sugar okay, honey, organic maple syrup, that kind of thing, or all a no-no?
I don't like making all or nothing statements.
Me neither.
But what happens, I think, when people say, oh, well, I'm not going to use any sugar, is then they go to chemically processed sugar that is, in my opinion, way worse for them. So, like, you know, Sweet and Low, and I don't even know the names of them because I don't use them. But chemically processed fake sugar is way worse for you. So, in my opinion, I would rather have someone be using honey, raw organic sugar, or maple syrup as a sweetener. But even that can become sort of someone's crutch if they really haven't given up sugar in their life, meaning, you know, if you're addicted to sugar and you're consuming a high amount of sugar, whether it's fruit sugar or through honey or maple syrup that's considered more healthy, you're still overloading your body with sugar intake. So until you can slow that down and bring it back to a healthy level of sugar, convincing yourself that you're eating healthier sugar is not really the way to go, because it's still creating a problem in the body. So I'm not somebody who avoids sugar completely from my diet, but I'm super conscious of it now, and I make choices. And when I make those choices, they are much better choices than the, you know, I don't know if you realized I'm in my little sister's room, but this bucket of just, to me, poisonous sugar is like, I wouldn't put it in my mouth anymore because it doesn't taste good to me. It tastes like chemicals. High fructose corn syrup tastes disgusting to me now. But she's addicted to this. Like, you can't get this away from her.
Are you going to, like, purge her room of all the candy when you leave?
So just very quickly for anyone who didn't get the, I live in New York, but I'm visiting Florida, and of course I'm staying in my 12-year-old sister's room covered in the, you know, Justin Bieber and Selena Gomez posters. No, she's a full-on sugar addict, and I've had interventions, I've done everything that I can, and this little kid hid gum in the shower. She, like, pockets it. Oh, she's her own special thing. So to that point, you can't force anyone to stop their addiction, but you can give them reasons that empower them to make a better choice, and that's what I try to do with her without coming down and being the hard person. I was going to say a bad word after that, but...
Well, one of my philosophies in, you know, cooking healthy comfort food is to eat a lot of good with a little bad, just so you feel like, again, it's not a totally omission-free philosophy, and that you're still getting some of those, like, comfort notes hit. So now that we've talked about the bad, do either of you have any kind of prescriptions, especially for clear skin and certain things that you should eat or integrate, like, daily into your diet to kind of, like, at least in a preventative way, or even if you get, like, flare-ups that you should try and consume?
What comes to mind for me, and thank you, Kristen, for mentioning the sugar piece. I feel like that's almost such a given for me that I forget to mention it. It's like, oh, yeah, of course. But that's such a massive, massive, massive piece for skin in every way and for the body in every way. And just to sort of, like, add to the detoxing off sugar conversation a little bit, I remember in my nutritional training when we were talking about, you know, getting people off sugar, if they're, like, majorly addicted, like Kristen's talking about, to high fructose corn syrup, candy, that, like, yeah, for them, eat a spoonful of honey. Just, like, go for it, even multiple times a day if you need to, just to detox off those really sort of, like, really bad sugars. And then your body sort of starts to recalibrate and recalibrate and recalibrate as you reduce your sugar intake. And all of a sudden, before you know it, like, fruit tastes like candy, and it's just, like, crazy explosive in your mouth. But now that we have talked about the bad, there are definitely some good, obviously, fresh fruits and vegetables, whole foods, depending on, you know, your diet, if you eat, like, fish or meat, that sort of thing, making sure that it is from a happy place without hormones, without any added chemicals, antibiotics, things that we really don't need in our bodies. And then little things like, for example, zinc is really helpful with skin healing. Pumpkin seeds are a really great source of zinc, so having a handful of pumpkin seeds, and they actually also help to release tryptophan, so having some pumpkin seeds before bed for a nice night's rest. Antioxidant berries for sure. Greens, and in the winter here in New York, you know, it's still so cold, and people are, like, posting their green juices and green smoothies every single day, and for some body types that works, and for others you might want to have your greens steamed or in a soup, and that might, you know, feel better to your body. But it's the same things that we've always known, you know, fresh fruits and vegetables, whole foods, drinking lots of water, that's a big one. You know, sometimes I have clients who are doing so many pieces of the puzzle right, and they're still like, oh, yeah, I, like, drink 3 cups of water a day, and I don't sleep enough. It's kind of like, those are our basics. Those are our building blocks. As human beings, we need sleep and water to function. And they don't call it beauty rest for nothing. Like, you need adequate sleep if your skin is going to heal. That's when our body detoxes. That's when the skin repairs. And people really notice a difference when they just increase their water intake and get adequate sleep.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. Well, that's incredibly useful. Obviously, all things that I am a champion of anyway. But now I want to segue into the realm of products, because I know that's probably what a lot of people who are tuning in today want to hear about. And it's, of course, what I struggle with, because even though I subscribe to everything that you just said, I have yet to totally switch over to natural products in terms of my makeup routine. And I don't know why. I think it's a lot of it is just rooted in habit and tradition, and also vanity and fear that you're not going to get your problems solved and be your most beautiful self without these, you know, proven and, you know, culturally lauded products that everyone seems to be wearing, including all the beautiful actresses on television. And, like, even though, in theory, I know that putting chemicals on my countertops, which I use naturals for, and then putting, like, some of the same chemicals on my face is, like, probably even worse, I haven't been able to, you know, just purge all the things that I've been relying on my whole life. So I guess, Kristen, I want to turn it over to you. And just talk to us about, you know, what are some of the baby steps for someone like me who's just starting off trying to integrate new things into the lifestyle? There are certain products that are bigger, or, I don't know, lesser of the evils than others, ones that we should switch out right away, others that can be slowly integrated over time. Give us your whole spiel on why. Give me the argument for natural solutions.
Okay. Well, one thing that you already said, which is so important, that I don't think most women are aware of when it comes to the conversation of switching to new beauty products, is that they are afraid that the change is going to leave them somehow in a worse off state than what they've become accustomed to using. And our loyalty as women to our products is pretty big. That's why companies spend so much money trying to lure us in, you know? So really, it's about becoming smarter than them in regards to the message they're sending you about what you need. So when we talk about listening to our bodies for food, you know, it's a little bit trickier with makeup because it's not like you put makeup on and your body sends you a signal. However, your skin can send you a signal with the skincare products that you're using and the makeup that you're using. And my best, outside of my own personal experience that I shared with you earlier about the changes I saw in my own skin, my best example of this is that for many, many, many years, over seven, I've been doing runway shows for all the fashion weeks in New York, Milan, and Paris. So what happens is all the same models, makeup artists, and hairstylists, about 80% of the same people travel to each city together. So by the time fashion month is over, I mean, the poor models are destroyed. Their skin is absolutely destroyed. And of course, it's during Paris where it's the most makeup and the most hair and the most elaborate everything. And what I realized was that models are a very good look at what women are doing slowly over a long-term time frame with our beauty products. Models are a great way to see what happens if that time gets compressed, because they're having so much beauty put on them and they're having so much beauty taken off of them that their skin is a wreck. And these girls are under 23. Most of them are around 18. And so seeing that they've developed allergies to really popular makeup, and you can't touch them with most any cleansers or moisturizers, and they get very particular about what goes on their skin because the flare-ups happen so immediately. So what that means to me with regards to regular women slapping stuff on every day is you might not see it today, you might not see it tomorrow, but you're going to see the effects of putting harsh chemicals on your skin eventually. And we all want to live happy, healthy, vibrant lives. the idea that your skin, which is an organ, and it's the largest organ in your body, is potentially absorbing things that go into your bloodstream and can toxify your body might be reason enough to consider products that would nourish and support your body's functioning as opposed to work against it and give your liver more to process through. Because your poor liver, right, it's like trying to deflect all this stuff that comes at it, and then we wonder why we have bad skin. So really, there's just so many reasons. And if you're the mom of a young child, or you're someone's sister, you're someone's partner, living longer is often just a good enough reason for people to want to make healthier choices in their lives. But the other really awesome reason is that you'll actually look better when you start treating your body and your skin like you truly care about it.
Awesome. Britta, do you have anything to add on that front?
Yeah, I think you were asking about sort of like, are there products that are more important to switch out immediately, and are there some that we could sort of wait on a little bit? And I would say the products that stay on your skin the longest are the ones that you want to switch the first. So your moisturizers, your foundation, the things that are really going to be soaking in. You know, ultimately, yeah, we want your cleanser to be all natural and safe as well, and you don't want to be stripping your skin with harsh chemicals, but it stays on your skin for maybe 30 seconds. And so if someone's making a transition, I would suggest, you know, as you run out of the conventional chemical-filled product that you're using, one by one, replace them with more natural options. And again, the first and most important ones are the ones that are going to be really soaking in, because we do absorb them through our skin. You know, think about the birth control patch, the nicotine patch. Those chemicals are being delivered into our bloodstream, and so are the chemicals in our products, many of which are proven to cause cancer. You know, I have had multiple clients that have been diagnosed with cancer, and then they're told by their doctors as one of the first things, remove products with parabens from your beauty regimen. And I think that as women, we really need to empower ourselves to remove those now, before we get the diagnosis, before shit hits the fan. You know, we have no reason to be using those. The reasons those, you know, preservatives are in there is so that we can keep our Pantene in the shower for a year and it won't go moldy. And there are safer alternatives, and we really, really don't need them. Products don't need to last for 80 years. So that's my take.
Awesome. So, I mean, going back to the loyalty thing, and I think, I mean, everyone falls victim to advertising, and you just don't see the names of natural beauty products appearing as often in the popular vernacular as you do, you know, the CoverGirls and Pantene's of the world. So, like, what are the best places to start shopping for these products? Like, I don't even, like, I know Whole Foods as one of them, and of course online, but again, in kind of testing things out, really feeling like you're investing in a good option for you, versus, like, my trial and error happened for the generic products over the course of 10 years, and now I've landed on my five things that I love. But especially because natural products are more expensive, large in part, than generic products, how do you, like, begin to test it out and to find what's right, and where do you buy them to make those choices easier?
Well, I definitely want to hit really quick on the natural products are more expensive by and large, because it depends on what sort of cosmetics you're buying. If you're buying Suave, okay, I could see the argument for that. But if you're out there splurging on your Chanel Lemire foundation, you cannot tell me that that is less expensive than something natural. So first, I like to sort of like bust through that, where if you're really a budget shopper and you really don't, you know, choose products that are higher than mass market pricing, maybe it's a little bit more of an issue for you. But I will say that products that are formulated better in the natural category are made with less fillers and less cheap ingredients, and therefore they're more potent, they're more effective, and you need less of them. I cannot tell you how much less product I go through using something that is all super high quality natural organic ingredients, then that like giant jumbo pump thing that one would keep in the shower and foams everywhere, because you have to use so much, because if you look, a lot of times the first ingredient in your shampoo or your body wash is water. Why are we paying for that, you know? So it's not really cheaper. It's a mentality thing. You're getting a big jug of something, but it's really, like, free water, you know? Anyway, so that is number one, to become a little bit smarter and more aware about what are you paying for. And when it comes to choosing products in the stores, I mean, gosh, I really wish I could say there was one natural chain store that you could physically go to that was all across America. The closest thing, I think, is Whole Foods and their whole body section, which a lot of people aren't aware that Whole Foods sells body products and moisturizers, skincare and hair care and makeup. And that's a great place to start, because sometimes they have samples or they'll give you samples, they'll make them into little containers. And, you know, they've got a really nice return policy. So if you hate it, hate it, they're pretty good about just letting you refunding your money and letting you get something else. There are online stores now who are taking the same model, and they'll send you out samples. One of the makeup lines I really love is Olema Pure, and they're a mineral-based line of cosmetics, and they have foundations and eyeshadows. And so that you can choose the right shade of foundation, they'll send you these cute little mini jars for $1.50 each, and you can select up to four, and I think it's $2 shipping, so minimal investment, and you can try it. Other than that, there are other natural health food stores. I mean, you could go potentially to some Sephora's, some Ulta Beauty's, and some drugstores and find natural products. By and large, I've not seen the most amazing selection of the highest quality products in most of those stores. So for me, they're a little bit of that. Is it a better choice? Probably. Is it the best choice? You know?
So that's another question that I have, and I don't want to cut you off, Britta, if you wanted to add to what Kristen just said, but how do you know what to trust? Because now everyone's saying natural this, natural that. And especially if you are in somewhere like a Duane Reade and you see Burt's Bees and like some other section of natural products, like, can you trust those things anymore?
No.
I don't trust anything at Duane Reade to be natural.
No.
So yeah, tell us exactly what we need to look for.
So do not trust the front of the package if it says natural. Even if it says organic these days, that don't mean a whole lot. Look at the back of the package. You know, and I really want to encourage people, again, to empower themselves to read ingredient labels just like they would with food. Look at what's in there. Are there a bunch of long words that you don't understand? Then you might want to look a few of those up. You know, we will have resources, as we talked about, you know, naming a few of the top chemicals to avoid. And just, you know, do a quick search on it. And it will come up pretty quickly if it's something really nasty or not. And I believe there are some apps, maybe. I don't know if that's available for skincare yet, but there are more and more resources coming available. But the front of a package is going to lie to you. There, you know, it's not regulated when they say natural. And even, you know, the USDA organic symbol is becoming a little bit more questionable than it used to be. And so look at the ingredients. If you see like five things and you've got like honey and walnut shells and a few things that look like herbs, awesome. Chances are we're not going to find a whole lot of that in those stores that were mentioned yet. Whole Foods will be your best bet. But even still, just because it comes from Whole Foods, like a client proudly sent me an image of a sunblock that they bought the other day. They're like, look, I'm going on vacation and I got this sunblock from Whole Foods. And I was like, yeah, but, you know, maybe there's a better option. And I actually made a suggestion and I ended up being able to exchange it at Whole Foods because they are totally awesome about that. And again, you know, just websites, searching things out. Unfortunately, the world of green beauty still is a little bit like the Wild West, and you kind of have to look out for yourself. But there are more and more and more resources coming available all the time, and it is becoming more mainstream. So I hope that it's going to be easier for people in the future to make really smart choices for themselves.
Well, and that's exactly what the goal of Green Beauty Team has been, is to give people information that's quality information that they can implement immediately into their lives. So whether it's selecting a product, like Britta will write about amazing natural skincare that she really loves, I'll write about makeup, you know, there's different, and then sometimes we'll just write about general advice, like, you know, how to drink enough water in a day, how to avoid eating sugar, and, you know, what to replace it with. So there are lots of websites trying to help the consumer be empowered and figure out how to get through the wild, wild west, as Britta so rightly put it. There's a term that gets tossed around, and it's worth looking up, called greenwashing. And that's because just if you see, I'm looking to the side because my little sister's room is just filled with beauty products, and oh my gosh, she's a total tween. But I'm just trying to see if there's anything that sort of represents this. But you get a product that has, like, this isn't a good example, but a bamboo leaf on it, and it's got green, and yeah, and maybe there's a drop of water, and all of a sudden, without even reading, even if it said natural on it, we're like, ooh, it's essences of strawberries in the field, great. You know, but actually what it should say is it's just still a bunch of toxic chemicals. So greenwashing is really where a company brings you into this experience and wants you to believe that you're getting herbal and natural, and so they make the package really sexy like that. And if you believe that, because that's what they want you to believe, without turning the package over and seeing if the ingredients are as Britta described, then yeah, that you've been greenwashed.
Well, I don't know if you both know this, but I used to work in beauty, so I can firsthand attest to greenwashing because I definitely used to do it to some extent at my old job. One of the places that I used to work was Kiehl's, and I think not necessarily because of the packaging imagery, like for the opposite reason, because it was so apothecary chic. I think a lot of people assume that Kiehl's was a super natural brand, and you know, just because they use natural ingredients like olive oil in their shampoo doesn't mean that it doesn't also contain all those other things. So that's just one of the many things that have contributed to my not upgrading to the green universe thus far, because I have a lot of free products from them still.
And if you feel like you're being lied to, then it's kind of like, why do I want to put my money there? Who can I trust? And you know, the real truth of it is that a company could put in one drop of, you know, an essential oil, and now on the front of the package, like, made with rosemary essential oil. Yeah, because they put one drop in a vat that was, you know, huge, because there are no laws regulating the amount of natural that goes into something before a company can claim that it is. And so I feel for people like you who have been exposed to greenwashing or who have been disappointed or feel like they're being duped, because there are some great brands out there who are so ethical and they are so committed to people's health. And those are the brands that you want to seek out and get behind, because that's the energy of healthy transformation in those products.
So, of course, there are many resources on Green Beauty Team, which we'll share with you guys on the event page. And, of course, I encourage everyone to go to the site and just have a little look around. But back just, like, to the nitty-gritty in terms of the back of the package. Like, of course, with food, I look for the non-GMO label. I look for the certified organic. Are there any things like that that we should most certainly pay attention to?
Honestly, it's tough to really say that, you know, it's totally safe if it has this. Sometimes even products will have, you know, the USDA organic, the cruelty-free symbol, the little rabbit, you know, all these different things. And they could still have something in there that isn't necessarily helpful for you. And as I'm sure you see with food as well, you know, for example, like a local small farmer might not have the money to get the USDA organic label, but it's a super quality product that they're selling, their cows are so happy, whatever, whatever. You know, not all products, if it is like a small line with a lot of integrity, has the money to put behind it for, you know, A, the advertising, and B, all these little seals that we can look for and trust, because it all costs money. I think it's really about looking at the ingredients, looking at what comes first, like Kristen saying, you know, it could be like, ooh, with argan oil or with vitamin C or with this and that, but is there actually enough in there for it to be active? And is it put in the product in a way that is actually available to your skin? So, for example, with the rosemary oil, if the very last ingredient is rosemary oil, then you know it's that one drop in a huge vat. Whereas if it's one of the top couple of ingredients, you know that that's actually an active in there and it's going to be benefiting your skin. And as far as the, you know, the ingredients, again, it's, they're like really challenging words, and it's best to just like have a handout, have a resource, but you want to look for parabens. That's a really big one. And even really big companies like Johnson & Johnson and Neutrogena are starting to remove parabens from their products, which is fantastic and a huge step, and it still doesn't mean that their products are going to be, you know, nutrient-rich or incredibly beneficial for your skin or not have any other harmful stuff. Fragrance is a really big one to look out for. You don't want it to smell like that, like, cucumber melon lotion that you used in high school. And you're just like your palate adjusts to less sugar, your nose starts to adjust to natural fragrances, to the point where if I go into a Sephora now, like, it gives me a massive headache and I start to panic, like, immediately. Like, you can sniff out artificial fragrance like a bloodhound. And so you can tell if it, you know, you'll see on the package fragrance, and also you can smell the product and know if it's natural or not. And one of the really gnarly chemicals that goes along with fragrance is phthalates. And they aren't always listed on there, but they're a really, really, really bad class of chemicals that do a lot of internal damage. And even on fragrance-free products, sometimes they still have phthalates and sort of what's called masking fragrance, so that it just kind of neutralizes what you're smelling, so that it smells like nothing, but there's still, they've got that sort of other thing on top of it, how the product would smell on its own without anything else. So not even fragrance-free is always fragrance-free. It's really about being an advocate for your own health and your own skincare and just looking through that ingredient listing. And again, most things are going to look like chemicals if they're chemicals. You know, once in a while with, you know, natural ingredients, it will have a long name and it will, you know, or have the Latin name. But usually you'll have the layman's terms in brackets after that. So if things look suspicious, a lot of the time they are. And again, just like a quick Google search or looking on the Environmental Working Group site, it's EWG.org, that can be really helpful. They list a lot of chemicals on there and sort of how bad it is. So if you have a product already and you're looking up like, oh, how bad is this? Okay, it's like, you know, a level 2. You know, I can still use this on my skin and I'm not going to like drop dead. It's okay. But if you've got like level 10, red alert, you might want to just throw that in the garbage if you're going through your beauty cabinet now and looking up what's in what you're already using.
Well, that's a really great next step, just to go through and kind of educate yourself on what you've been using so far. I think that's what I'm going to do, at least to start.
Well, I would tell you that it's going to be a little challenging if you're looking for ingredients on things that you already have, because manufacturers typically put their ingredients on boxes, which you throw out. So if you think you're going to pick up your lotion that you've had for a while and know what's on, or, you know, what's in it, you're not going to find the ingredients probably on the tube. So just as an FYI, that's why you might have to do a Google search. And EWG is a great resource, but don't allow yourself to be completely alarmed by it, because I feel like it can be a little bit scary, especially if it's the first time you've been on there and you're like, oh my God, everything's an 8, you know, because their scale is 1, which is low hazard, to, or 0, which is no hazard, to 10, which is the most hazardous. And there's data gaps. You know, that's not necessarily, don't go throw yourself off a bridge with all that, you know, fear that you might have if you see your products are pretty high on the scale. And to that point, we have on Green Beauty Team a toxic ingredient glossary with listed at the top the what I call the major offenders. So the ingredients that, like what Britta just suggested, fragrance, parabens, and phthalates, which are never listed on ingredient labels, but they're a part of synthetic fragrance. Those are all described in that glossary, what you'll find them in typical products, like if it comes in a hair product or nail polish or whatnot. And then what is the risk associated with using that type of an ingredient? So if you were going to do a baby step, I would say, first and foremost, see if you can't replace your products that have synthetic fragrance in them, or parfum, it's often listed as, and just get rid of those. Because most likely, you're going to be also then getting rid of a whole host of other ingredients that are no bueno, you know? It's like, they come together as a little package. That and the parabens, I really am not a huge fan of petroleum oil, mineral oil, and I am a big proponent of not using sodium lauryl sulfate, sodium lauryl sulfate, because I feel, and maybe Britta will either tell me that I'm crazy or not, but that it actually strips the skin of its natural protective oil and therefore leaves it more raw and vulnerable for anything that you put on top of the skin afterwards to more readily absorb into the system. So chuck all the stuff that foams and smells like your cucumber, melon, strawberry fields. Chuck it all. And just find things that are more natural in that department. And you can start creating your own blends, too, by putting in, you know, a little drop here and there of lavender oil or something that is pleasing to your senses but is not going to add on the negative consequences that a synthetic fragrance or other chemicals will include.
So would you say, like, any sort of luxury, like, spray fragrance, huge, like, number one no-no?
Yeah. I'm sorry. Yeah, I mean, so here's the thing. There, in cosmetics, fragrance can have up to 200 different chemicals in it. Some people say 2,000, but regulated within cosmetics of what you find in makeup in fragrance is about 200. Those 200 chemicals do not have to be listed on a package, and those chemicals can do so many bad things to the body, including trigger headaches, like Britta mentioned. I don't know if it can trigger panic attacks, but headaches, nausea, which I totally get nauseous if a guy with lots of cologne walks through, you know, and or I have to sit on the subway next to a guy who's just oozing some sort of man cologne. Oh, and they should know that there are some pretty credible studies done where it showed how when a man was sprayed with synthetic perfume cologne, within 3 minutes, his sperm count dropped 33%. So when we talk about, yeah, which, okay, this is not a birth control tip, by the way, so don't go thinking you can start spraying cologne all over some guy. But what that says is that the chemicals within the fragrance actually have negative reproductive effects. Now, that's not just for men, although it definitely affects men. Also for women, the phthalates can act as estrogen. They mimic estrogen. They disrupt the endocrine system. And if you know anything about female health, your female hormones, your thyroid, which is your connected to your endocrine system, basically rule your life. And if these are out of balance, you are crazy and unhappy. That's kind of what we'll put it at. So if you could get rid of fragrance, you already so many things will come back into balance in your body that maybe you weren't even aware were connected to your beauty products. Now, of course, I say this as not a doctor, and I'm not giving anyone medical advice. Let's just put that out there now.
No, it's really interesting, though. I mean, it's all connected, and I think that's something that we forget, especially as we dive into the world of beauty and finding that perfect concealer, perfect moisturizer, perfect everything for our life. So really quick, I want to touch on, we've got some questions in the Q&A section, which is wonderful. Thank you all. The first one's from Kath N, and she's asking for tips for natural skincare makeup application on larger pores.
Well, Britta?
Well, larger pores means oilier skin. One of the things that's really helpful for, you know, helping to clean out larger pores is doing, like, a weekly clay mask. So that could be, you know, a step in the right direction to balancing skin and working on those pores a little bit naturally. And, you know, using products that are geared towards that skin type. And like Kristen was saying, too, you know, avoiding the really foamy stuff that strips your skin, because a lot of the time, if you strip the skin, it's going to produce more oil in reaction to being stripped, because it wants to have its protective barrier back. So cleansing your skin gently and diligently, trying that clay mask once a week, regular exfoliation is important for all skin types, but especially, again, the larger pores indicate more oil production, and with that comes also a little bit higher cell turnover rate. So you're going to need to scrub a little bit more frequently than, say, other skin types.
Cool. All right, next one, because we're almost out of time. What do you all think of the Skin Deep, the cosmetics database?
Well, we touched on that just a minute ago. That's the Environmental Working Group's database.
Oh, okay, great.
Yeah.
Well, Helen White, who wrote about that, is suggesting they may have an app now, so that might be something to look into. Okay, last question. About taking care of your hair with green products, I've heard using baking soda and cider vinegar for washing your hair. Have you tried that? Do you recommend it?
Don't do it. Don't do it, please. You really don't want to combine those two things together, and Britta can maybe speak more towards the chemical reaction, because I can just tell you that you're basically going to ask for brittle, dry, nasty hair if you continue to put those sorts of products together, because the vinegar has a lot of acid, and the baking soda is very alkaline, and it's not a great combination. Is that right, Britta?
I'm not exactly sure. I've been hearing more people lately. I feel like this is something that's become a trend maybe in the last few months, like people sort of reporting to me like, oh, I'm going to try this, and I'm like, let me know how it goes. I do know that as natural drain cleaner, I use baking soda and vinegar. So I don't know if you use the same thing that's effective as a drain unclogger on your head.
Yeah, I wouldn't put that far. That's also harsh, because it's creating a chemical reaction. And we actually have a great article on Green Beauty Team. One of our writers decided to go no poo, which is what that trend is. It's the no shampoo. And she went through her whole experience. It's pretty funny if you've never tried it, because, you know, she had a job interview, and she had to wash her hair, and, you know, it was just all this kind of funny stuff she gets to the point at the end where then she reveals what finally worked for her. And it's a combination, I believe, of honey and apple cider vinegar that she massages into her scalp. But there's no baking soda. And baking soda on the skin, you know, we even have an article about that, about how it can be a good exfoliant, but you've just got to be really aware that it can also dry out the skin quite a bit. And so the goal, whether it's natural or not, the scalp or your face, is not to cause a chemical reaction that is really harsh on your body.
Awesome. Okay, one more. How bad is talc in eyeshadows and other powder products?
Well, talc in eyeshadow doesn't bother me. Talc in things that sort of poof up and you inhale them, so if it was like in a powder and you sort of had that powder cloud experience, or you're using a dry shampoo, a friend of mine from Italy, I have a lot of Italian friends with amazingly humorous products that they show up with, and I'm, you know, and he was in the bathroom, and he sprayed this talc deodorant spray, and then he shut the door to the bathroom, and I was the next person to walk in the bathroom. And I swear I almost choked to death. I walked in, I breathed it in, and went, and I was dying for, not dying, but, you know, really having an adverse reaction to it. So talc is really a problem when it's ingested into the lungs, and that's where it can cause toxicity from inhalation. I don't think topically on the skin that's, like, so much of an issue. However, if you're putting a lot of it on your body, like baby powder and all of this, especially near your sensitive parts, your membranes that are more absorbent, I wouldn't so much do that. That I would definitely avoid. You could use something like cornstarch or other talc-free natural products that also offer that same absorbency without the potential negative side effects. Plus, you don't know how the talc was processed. So is the chemical that was used to process the talc also toxic?
Awesome. Yeah, and I would just like to add, you know, sometimes with talc you see aluminum as well, and that's something that we do not want on our skin. We do not want to be working with aluminum. You know, there's huge studies about aluminum in the brain, Alzheimer's, as well as other complications. So that would be my beef with talc.
Awesome. Well, if anyone else has any other questions, you can feel free to write them in to the event page, which we'll be checking back and adding some resource links to. And of course, if you want to tweet with the hashtag Wellness Wednesday, either of these lovely ladies will respond on Twitter. And I'm going to do a little write-up of this whole conversation on Feed Me Phoebe next week with some of the highlights, some of the resources again, and perhaps maybe a few follow-up questions from the ladies. So before we wrap up, I assume from everything we talked about today that really the green philosophy is something that carries into every aspect of your lifestyle, which is amazing, and it's really hard to do, as I know, because mine mainly resides in the kitchen. But are there any places that you struggle, any guilty pleasures that you want to share with us? I mean, we're all human here.
I would say my biggest pitfall is just that, you know, sometimes something happens, like I'll get sick or I'll have a really busy work week or travel and I get out of my routines, and it's really hard for me to get back to yoga, get back to exercising, and I might skip a few of my little morning routines. And I have to say boxed mac and cheese. I know, it's so bad. I'm gluten intolerant, so I get my little gluten-free noodles and I'll use like the little packet. That's my extreme comfort food. Like, we're talking serious PMS or heartbreak, and I have to have it. It's like the flavor of my childhood. Guilty pleasure.
Love it. Kristen?
Oh, okay, so I don't want this to come off of like, there's nothing wrong with me. I have no guilty pleasures. But like, I kind of have become sort of an extremist. And so, I mean, my guilty pleasures are more like, now I have these gluten-free, non-GMO cookies that I bake at night after dinner. It's like, it's the most banal answer you could possibly hope for.
What about wine? I know you drink wine.
Okay, but you know what? I don't consider that a guilty pleasure. Maybe that goes back to the beginning of the conversation. I try never to tell myself that I'm good or bad because of a choice I'm making. Because if I'm consciously making a choice to have a glass of wine, then it's serving my body in a good way. Because there can be benefits to wine if you're not drinking the whole bottle every night. And I do try to drink organic wine whenever I have access to it. So, really, I don't know. My guilty pleasures have become so healthy, it's just like the saddest question to answer anymore. But I do eat sugar. I do break food rules if I'm at someone's home and they've cooked me a meal and I don't know where the meat came from or I don't know where the vegetables came from. I'll eat the food because I feel it's better to indulge in that experience than it is to restrict myself from that experience.
Yeah. I hear that. Well, ladies, thank you so much. This has been hugely educational, and I'm happy that this video is going to live on YouTube and the event page for anyone who didn't make it live today. And yes, that concludes our Green Beauty first Wellness Wednesday chat. I hope you'll come back for the next one. They're going to be every 2 weeks, and the next one we're going to be covering all the different ways you can drink to your health. With a couple people who are just starting to develop their own products in that space as kind of a counterpart to the green juices that you see everywhere. So thanks again. Have a great rest of the week, and be healthy and happy. Bye.